to discuss fully get approval of yung committee report on this congressional inquiry, and we will conduct this in executive session. So members only itong aming hearing, kasi the whole idea is to share this with all of the members. This is in draft, and for draft, first draft ito of the committee report, and only for discussion purposes. Kanya, we are not yet ready to share this with the public, or to the public. So ngayon lang siguro we will just open, and then we will conduct our hearing in executive session. So yung mga members and not even the staff, yung ano lang, yung secretariat lang, ano? What is the rule on executive session? Sinong pwede? Ah, ganun. So yun lang po tayo. Later, siguro for now, we will give an opening remarks. And then just to give you an idea of where we are. But we hope to get this done within the day. And we hope to get this approved within the week before we go on a break. And so yun po yung atin. Okay. So as we speak, meron pa pong ginagawa dun sa, hindi pa po final draft yung what we have, and the secretariat is still working on it, but we need to discuss this at the committee level, because later on we will vote upon it, or at the proper time we will vote upon it, and we need to get a consensus, and hopefully we can obtain a consensus from all members who will vote upon this committee report. So, and then eventually in plenary also. So yun po yung pre or preliminary announcement for the media. Tapos for the members naman, since we are in executive session, yung draft po natin bibigay namin sa inyo. But before you leave, we will collect it again so that yung what we will agree on is what will come out as a final, in final form, that we will vote upon, that can now be shared to the public. But for the meanwhile, yung very rough draft, we will keep it to the committee and to the within the secretariat. So ganun po magiging what you can expect from the committee to the speaker. And we will all be there together, I guess, with the speaker. Wala ba? Sabi niya, 11:30, I got a text eh. Aywan ko kung kasama siya, but ano ba yan? Hindi ko makita eh. But anyway, there is notice at 11:30 na meron ganun. Eto. Press briefing on May 17 October at 11 AM. And the 11:30 yata yung ano. To cover Bilibid drug trade. Confirmation of 4 cabinet officials. Ayan, media briefing 17 October 2016 on Bilibid trade. Probe on confirmation of 4 cabinet officials on national budget, on charter change, on tax reforms, on other bills. On Philippine-US relations, on high approval trust rating of President, on support for success. On the scrapping of the Philippine, that's about it.
As of 10 a.m., we have 9 regular members and 4 ex-officials.
So, pwede na ba?
Meron na po, sir.
Ang ex-officio, kasama rin siya.
Ang ex-officio sa determination of the
calendar of business and report. Ah, sa ano na to? Yung
house rules, sir, house rules. House rules and
ito po, no, just for the information of everyone, house rules will not allow us, and if I may just quote, no committee report and its secretariat staff prior to the inclusion of the report in the calendar of business. So that is to guide all the members of what we cannot do in this particular report that will be outputted by the Committee on Justice. In relation to this legislation,
sabi mo sa kanya to move for ano? Pardon. Move to dispense with the roll call.
The meeting is now called to order.
Mr. Chairman, I respectfully move to dispense with the roll call.
Second.
It has been moved and seconded. The calling of the roll is hereby dispensed with. We now go to second agenda, approval of the minutes of previous meeting.
Mr. Chair, I move for the approval of the minutes of the meetings on September 7, 20, and 21. But may I request that we defer the approval of the minutes of our meetings October 6 and 10, because we have not. Received yet copies of this.
Any second to the motion? It has been moved and seconded. Minutes of the meetings dated September 7, 20, and 21 are approved, while we defer action on the minutes of October 6 and 10.
Mr. Chairman.
Please.
I don't have a copy with me of the minutes of the September 20 and 21, Mr. Chairman. But earlier, I was able to browse through the minutes, and I have noticed certain important items that should have been included in the minutes, but have been missed out, Mr. Chairman. For instance, in the case of the inconsistency of the testimonies of Ablen and Ragos, in the September 20 hearing, Mr. Chairman, that has not been noted in the minutes. So may I request, Mr. Chairman, that that matter be included, as it is very important, Mr. Chairman.
Secretariat, will you please look into this? Is there any motion to consider that and consider the minutes of September ano to?
September 20, Mr. Chairman.
September 20, approve in principle to include those corrections as you mentioned. Ano ba yun? Can you please clarify specifically?
Specifically, Mr. Chairman, in the case of the claim of Mr. Ablen that Mr. Ragos ordered him to collect from the inmates tara of 100,000 pesos a week, and that on the first week he was able to collect like 1 million pesos from the first 10 inmates that complied with the required with the instruction of Director Ragos, and in the succeeding weeks they were able to collect already from all 17 inmates. These were all denied by Director Ragos, Mr. Chairman, and that has not been included in the minutes, Mr. Chairman. I think that's very material in terms of determining the consistency of that the testimonies of our witnesses, Mr. Chairman.
You wanted what?
I wanted that included, Mr. Chairman. I think that's very material.
You, in succeeding hearings, Camo, what is that you wanted to, you know?
Well, I have yet to see the minutes for the October 6 and October 10 minutes, Mr. Chairman.
October 6 and 10, precisely, we have to defer approval of the minutes of October 6 and 10 because we have not received copies yet of that.
So does that satisfy your concern?
Yes, Mr. Chairman, as far as October 6 and October 10, Mr. Chairman, but as far as September 20, Mr. Chairman, may move that the minutes be corrected to include, Mr. Chairman, the statements of Ragos and Ablen that were inconsistent, Mr. Chairman.
We have approved it. If it's just a matter, anyway, we discussed that. The secretariat is directed to reflect whatever was raised by the good congressman on this particular point. And then for the secretariat to discuss the matter directly with the congressman. Okay.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Yes, sir. So anyway, uh, So may I now request the ComSec to please acknowledge the members present, including ex officio officers of the House of Representatives who are present in today's hearing.
Good morning. We would like to acknowledge the presence of the following House members of the committee: Honorable Reynaldo Umali, Honorable Rodolfo Pariñas, Honorable Vicente Veloso, Honorable Strike B. Revilla, Honorable Ramon Rocamora, Honorable Jericho Jonas Nograles, Honorable Lawrence Lemuel Fortun, Honorable Edward Vera P. Maceda, Honorable Jose Christopher Belmonte, Honorable Edwin Ong, Honorable Mahmoud Mendy, Honorable Luisa Loren Quaresma, Honorable Gwendolyn Garcia, Honorable Vincent Crisologo, Honorable Danilo Suarez, Honorable Alfredo Garbin, Honorable Eugene Michael De Vera, Honorable Anthony M. Bravo, and also the presence of our author, Honorable Romeo Acop and Honorable Gus. Honorable Romeo Acop. And other House members, Honorable Gaston Tambunting and Honorable Horacio Swan Singh Jr.
Thank you for that. So let me just welcome everyone to this committee hearing. This is not yet in executive session. Later on, we will conduct our hearing in executive session. But just for the benefit of especially the public, you know, this is this legislative inquiry is a records, is a record of some sort. We started our hearings on September 20 and terminated the same after four hearings on different dates in on October 10. This is less than a month. And actually, we will now discuss today and hopefully approve a committee report that the committee had put together for discussion purposes, and to seek the consensus of this committee in approving the same, so that we can present this in plenary within a month from the time we started, even if the rules allow us to complete our work in a period of 60 days. So we hope to seek plenary approval of our committee report. Hopefully we can agree on it today, so that before we go on a break this week, we would have presented and get the nod of the House of Representatives of our output in this particular congressional inquiry. I would like to thank everyone, especially the members, because this is probably the most expeditious, swiftest, productive congressional inquiry ever, completed in four hearings in four different days for a total of 47 hours, ranging from 10 to 14 hours per hearing, comprehensively covering 22 witnesses and 10 resource persons and or agencies, including two non-government organizations, notably the Integrated Bar of the Philippines and even the VACC, or Volunteers Against Crime and Corruption. The, both of these groups really participated, well, joined us in all of the hearings, and they submitted to the committee their inputs also on what legislative measures we can pursue as a result of this congressional. Inquiry. More in interpolating with, you know, the people who saw us being transparent and conduct our proceedings in an orderly fashion. I would like to thank all of you, and we don't want to keep you waiting. And this is the reason why we would like the committee report to be tackled soonest. First in this committee and then eventually in the floor, so that we can already report to the country what we have accomplished in this congressional inquiry pertaining to House Resolution 105 on the proliferation of drug syndicates in the Bilibid prison. While I lament some negative comments from some of our colleagues here in Congress, whom I respect highly, but unfortunately did not also participate in our hearings, I do respect their opinions, but I wish they will find it in their hearts to see this congressional inquiry as, again, one shining moment of the House of Representatives. No? So having said that, I would like to perhaps request members only to, are we using the same room? We will be using the same room so that we will expect only members and the secretariat. And for those House members who wish to participate but are not allowed under our rules, I think discretion is given to the chair to also accommodate them. Pare-pareho lang naman po tayong halal ng bayan, and I do not want to disallow you to participate because I know that if we allow everyone to participate, we will better get a consensus of the final output that we will submit to plenary, which we will vote upon anyway when we are about ready to do that. Meanwhile, after we have excused all those who cannot participate in this executive session, we will distribute copies of the first draft of the committee report for discussion purposes, and we will have to collect the same again before we end our executive session. And so we can give the secretariat time to finalize it. And once finalized, this is what we can vote upon. And after we have approved the same and get it calendared in plenary, then we will be free already and without obligation or constraint to share it with everyone. I guess that is, again, what the rules require of us members. So, Your Honors, please be guided accordingly. And may I now request any comment at this point in time while the media is still here before we request the media to allow us our free time as a committee conducting this hearing in executive session. Any comments coming from any member? Minority leader.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm just somewhat, I read one of the broadsheet today, and I just would like to have a clarification from the chair on that statement that there was no evidence against De Lima. Is that the position of the chair?
I don't know about whoever wrote that. Definitely it did not come from me. I did not utter those words. I did not give any statement to any media on that particular point. So probably that is a spin of some of the members of the media, and or probably that is their way of sowing intrigue on the House of Representatives, on this committee, and on this person as chair of the Committee on Justice.
Well, that's comforting, Mr. Chairman. I'm just somewhat alarmed or bothered because we're about to come up with a committee report, and here is a broadsheet news stating that the chair has made a statement that there is no evidence linking De Lima to this particular resolution, that I am one of the authors. That's precisely the reason why I am somewhat concerned. But nevertheless, coming from you that it is not true, then it's pretty comforting, and thank you very much for that reply.
Thank you, Minority Leader. Again, the rules do not allow us to divulge whatever is contained in the report because this is a very rough draft of the report, and I cannot speak for the committee. I am only a chairman of this committee. I cannot speak for the committee. The committee report is what will be the statement of this institution, not Congressman Umali, not Chairman Umali, but the Committee on Justice, of which I only have one, I only chair, and I only have one vote, which I cannot even exercise unless to break a tie when we vote upon any measure before this committee. So please disabuse your mind about whatever has been written, because that is a canard that no one should even listen to.
Mr. Chairman, in relation to the manifestation of the minority leader, Mr. Chairman, I heard over the radio when I drove my son to school this morning that you made a statement that the prosecution of Senator De Lima will not be one of the recommendations of the committee. Do you confirm that, Mr. Chairman?
That is not our job. Prosecution is an executive function, not a congressional function. Investigation and enforcement are executive functions, not legislative functions. So that is not our role. Our role is to legislate, and that is what we will focus on in our committee report. But having said that, that is not to say that we will not have our own findings of what facts had been established in this committee. And anyway, you will all see that in the draft committee report, and you make your own judgments as to what will be the output of this committee that I have steered towards producing this committee report for the approval of all members of this committee and then eventually the plenary.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes,
from what I understand from your explanation, this committee cannot make recommendations to the Department of Justice, cannot make recommendations to the NBP. Is that the rule, Mr. Chairman?
I did not say that. I did not say that. I'm just saying that that is not our function.
But we can
prosecution recommend. Is not our function.
But we can recommend in our resolution, Mr. Chairman.
I guess it can be done, but as you very well know, charges have already been filed. So what is there to recommend?
No, no, not only, for example, we can recommend
It is the decision of the committee, not mine.
But that's why I'm asking. We will not be able to suggest on the functions of the NBP, for example, that they should put up a net, something like that. Are we not allowed to? We will not be allowed to make recommendations in our resolution.
We are allowed.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you.
At any rate, Mr. Chairman, those who will not vote for the approval of the committee report and those who did not sign the committee report has the liberty to file their own concurring or dissenting opinion, Mr. Chairman. So those who will not agree can file their dissenting opinion, and those who agree and has different recommendation can also file their concurring opinion, Mr. Chairman.
We will look into that if that is allowed. You know, we are not also a court of law. I do not know if this is allowed under the rules.
That is allowed,
Your
Honor.
At the proper time, we will. We may have to rule on that.
Mr. Chairman, that is allowed under the rules. Under Section 16 of our Rules of Legislative Investigation, it says that those members who vote against the approval of the report and who do not sign the majority report may make concurring or dissenting opinions. And the same, the report can be filed with the Secretary General and be the subject of the order of business before the plenary, Mr. Chairman.
That is correct. That is Section 16, but not in this committee, but in the plenary through the Secretary General. So that is beyond the committee, and you have your time to do this in plenary when the matter is included in the order of business for purposes of deliberation and approval by the House in plenary. Ayaw niyo pa bang makita yung report? Bakit ang dami yung tanong?
Last night.
Hindi ba kayo na-excite sa report? Congressman Salo.
Yes, Mr. Chair. This is a different matter, Mr. Chair. I just note that this committee issued the warrant of arrest on Ronnie Dayan. So may I just inquire on what would be the status of that and what would be the action of the committee in as much as the committee is already terminating its investigation on this matter?
The warrant stays. The contempt stays because that is contempt of the House of Representatives, not only this committee. Please remember that the subpoena was issued and approved by the Speaker of the House, not by the Chair of this committee, and therefore that contempt is against the institution. Hence, as I said in our previous hearing, all unfinished business will be referred to the appropriate committees or even subcommittees of the Justice Committee. So he will have his time to respond to any and all questions that are to any and all questions that may be required by any member of this House in the appropriate committee. So the contempt order stays and the arrest order stays. So on that note, we would like again to thank our friends from the media for covering us even in this short period of time. Let me again reiterate that at 11:30, we will have a House briefing led by our good speaker. So, you know, you may raise all of the questions that you'd like to raise from us at that particular moment. Meanwhile, may I request your indulgence to please vacate this room so that we can proceed with
Before
our jobs.
Before that, Mr. Chair, may I move to conduct an executive session so we can properly convene for executive session, Mr. Chair.
Second motion, Your Honor.
been moved and seconded the hearing of the Committee on Justice is now in executive session. The committee directs the stenographers to please stay to record what
incremental increase annually. So ang ating pinakiusap sa kanila, kung ganoon din lang naman kalit, at tatanggalan natin ang privilege ng ating mga senior citizens and persons with disabilities, can we explore working with the legislature, between the legislature and the DOF, kung paano kami makakatulong maging mas tighter yung regime ng exemptions on senior citizens. Kung may, ibig sabihin, kung may nag-aabuso or nakakalusot or may loopholes, how can the legislature help to plug these loopholes?
Yung salary, sir.
So, ay yung pinag-aralan din yun kasi yung excise tax medyo mabigat. So, pinag-submit namin yung details kung gaano ba talaga ang magiging effect nito sa cascading down. Is it really less progressive or medyo progressive ba ang epekto ng increased excise on petroleum? So pinahiningi din natin na suriin ng mabuti kung ano magiging epekto nito sa competitiveness ng Pilipinas in the ASEAN market. Kasi syempre yung cost of energy, cost of living, cost of transport, kailangan competitive ang Pilipinas para ma-attract pa rin natin yung investment.
Sir, Deputy Speaker Noreen Dias, may mga changes po ba sa budget, amendments? Ano pong mga ni-introduce na amendments?
Very minimal yung changes. In-anticipate pa ng... although I'm not a member of the small group, si Chairman po ang member dyan. But traditionally, it will have very minimal changes. We anticipate major changes coming in sa Baltam. There's still time to connect yung President's budget message with the actual numbers. There are some areas which need to be improved upon, and there will be amendments proposed along the way. Even after the Baltam, that's what's being anticipated at this point.
So, and we also recognize the presence of one of our members of the Congressman Robin Sassi from the Partilist Kabayan. Yes, sir.
Nanayan Kaya from Tempo. The chairman, Kua. Would you feel, sir, that it is now the right time to buy a new car, considering the tax reform package in which a regular car will now be given imposed additional 400,000 pesos excise tax. Or, get a clear example, kung bibili ko ng Innova ngayon yung tao, mas makakatipid siya ng 400,000. Dahil kung matuloy ho yung batas na yan, plus 400,000. Kung bibili naman ang tao ng isang Innova, o kaya yung, ano ba yung sa Mitsubishi? Montero, 600,000 ang buhay dagdag na excise tax. So, by way of kwento, mas mabuti siguro bumili ng kotse na ngayon para makatipid ka. That is that proposal being discussed.
Tama po si Deputy Speaker at Ryan. Piling ko sa Pilipinas of Amendments na tayo.
Tanungin nyo.
May proposal nga po na nagtaga na excise on vehicles. So that is in part a reaction also to the traffic crisis. But kung mapasara po ito yung excise ng automobile, whether the will propose of UF or not, lower or higher now, it will affect definitely the prices of vehicles. So, kung mapasara itong version na to, better to purchase a vehicle before it passes. It will be more expensive after legislation.
So ngayon, dahil sa kanya,
depende sa klase ng
okay, here's the issue. Hindi ako net 3 yung depende sa presyo ng sasakyan. So kung magkano ang naging cost of importation ng manufacturer. Yung mas mura, syempre, mas total market size. Tapos yung mas mahal, mas mataas. Tapos yung pinakamahal, yung luxury, pinakamalaki.
So yung pinakita rin na ni Deputy Speaker Andaya, tama yung behavior na
Sir, you mentioned it's a part of the traffic crisis, so it's also partly intended to help reduce vehicle volume or vehicular volume sa kalye. Kasi ngayon parang dali na rin bumili ng kotse.
If you ask me, I do not 100% subscribe to that notion because this issue is limited to the urban areas like Metro Manila, Cebu, and a few other parts of the country. In places like Quirino or maybe Mindoro, traffic is not so much a problem. So we would like also for the people in our provinces to have the option to purchase a vehicle at an affordable package.
Sir Joyce Posse and then Philippines. Sir, just to clarify, what's your stand on this? Do you approve of it or are you also planning to oppose this?
Well, hindi naman yung ganun ka drastic whether I support or I oppose. I think it will really boil down to how much will contribute to the revenue gain and how much losses we need to compensate for because of the amendment of the first income tax package. So it seems like a proposal that's worth studying. Hindi naman natin ang kinasulatan.
Sir, paano yung second-hand sale?
Walang proposal. The proposal is still valid. Is it being currently with EOA? Not yet. It's still being discussed between the committee and the Department of Finance.
Sir,
Sir Ryan from the Post tonight. Sir, tanong ko lang, may proposal kaya na no parking, walang new vehicle, di ba? Yung proposal na yun to impose a higher excise tax sa new vehicle, eh, tingin mo okay na proposal to o baka na mamatay yung car industry?
Sa atin, okay yan, personally. Dahil lagi kong iniisip talaga, kahit na tayo magparami ng kalye, kung di naman natin i-regulate yung pagbili ng sasakyan, ganyan pa rin ang problema. So, nandito na si Chairman O'Malley, ang umanong si Howard.
Sir, O'Malley, just to clarify, does the House Committee on Justice plan to vote on the committee report during the executive session or do you plan to call a separate public hearing before presenting it sa plenary?
We will probably, we are in executive session now, I just took time off our meeting. Later, we will finalize it, we're just getting all the inputs from the concerned members, and then after that, I guess we'll open and get our hearing to the public.
But
so, within the day, siguro ito.
May hearing pa uli, sir.
Then, continuing to until we would have passed upon this committee report in the committee, so that we can now finalize it for presentation to the plenary. Before we go to bed.
So you plan to sort of call for the hearing that the media can cover? It could happen later, this afternoon later. Or tonight. Right.
Sir,
I'm
not thinking about it. Diane, hindi pa rin na walang paramdam. The whole country, we have directed, of course, our Sergeant at Arms, and likewise, all the law enforcement agencies. Meron ng reward na inoffer yung BACC. Wala ho si Speaker. I might also raise this issue with him.
Para ho mag-check
rewards ang bigyan ng board?
Meron ng rewards, BACC 100,000.
Kayo, how much paid lang yun?
Hindi pa namin napapag-usapan.
Can you propose to the speaker?
I think it's a good idea.
Sir, doon sa hearing, nung na-establish mo yung link talaga ni Dilima sa operations?
Yung link ni Dilima ay lahat yun ay sinabi ng lahat ng mga witnesses. Diba? Yung nag-deliver, etc., etc. Wala namang nag-rebut nun, walang nag-controvert nun. So, perhaps it will not be difficult to answer that because we will base it on what has been tested, on what has been said by the committee, by the witnesses, which up to now remains unrebutted. So, hindi nag-participate si Secretary de Lima, so you can already expect what is contained in the committee report. Now, ang gusto ko lang sabihin na it is not our job to determine whether credible yung witness na yun or yung may weight yung sinabi na may evidence or value or weight yung mga sinabi nila. We will leave that to the courts and we will leave that to the Department of Justice who will have to determine whether there is probable cause, prima facie evidence or you know, an evidence greater than that.
But sir, will you recommend, because as I understand, you personally said, sir, na sinabihan kayo ni Speaker not to recommend the prosecution of any individual, but earlier this morning, there were at least two congressmen who were asking you if rules bar you from prosecuting anyone, so mukhang may gusto po atang direction na puntahan niyo.
Ang gusto ni Speaker is for us to focus on the legislative measures that are expected of us because this is a congressional inquiry in need of legislation. Now, yung matter of prosecution is really an executive function. Yun ang ibig sabihin nun. And since the case has already been filed, what is for us there to recommend? Eh, naka-file na nga. Baka marami pa silang ipa-file. Nakakatatlo na yata na ipa-file. One coming from, to my understanding, Esmeralda and Lasala. And there is another group that also filed. So, tatlo na po yan. So it's a foregone conclusion. Recommending prosecution is already a state issue.
Mm. But you will, sir, it can be included in the report?
Well, what is included in the report is what we have established by way of accountability and involvement. And that is what we're discussing in executive session.
Pero you will also confirm the credibility of the witnesses.
That means this group, if you do that, there will be enough evidence to pin them down to Dilima and not others.
Nothing of that sort. Sabi ko nga sa inyo, it is not our function to determine the credibility of witness. That is more the function of the courts and the Department of Justice.
Yes. So what then will be the basis of your
the
resolution? If you will not... So if you discuss the testimonies, you also discuss the credibility of witnesses.
The unrebutted testimonies of witness will be our basis.
Sir, what is the basis for the decision not to make any recommendations when it comes to prosecution? Because I understand in previous instances, whenever there is a committee investigation and there is a committee report, if there is a recommendation for prosecution, it is endorsed to the either the DOJ or the Office of the Ombudsman. So, what is the basis of the Speaker? We understand that there are instructions from the Speaker. What is the basis for those instructions?
This is not a full-blown investigation like how they do it in the Department of Justice, where all concerned will be part of those to be charged. Like, for example, we will appear to be singling out Laila de Lima because what came out in the testimonies of the witness are only pointing to De Lima. But there are other accomplices, there are other culpable government employees like jail guards, etc., that we did not cover anymore in our investigation. So we would rather that DOJ do a complete PI or preliminary investigation so they can charge everyone rather than us telling them that you charge this and then forget about the others. So it's doing a complete staff work, and Congress has no capability. We do not have NBI, we do not have CIDG, we do not have intelligence people to dig deeper into the involvement of any and all those who may have violated the laws of the country. So we would rather let our co-equal bodies or co-equal branches of government do their jobs than us doing it for them.
Sir, may I just follow up on Ben's question? Ben's question.
Please.
Sir, di ba you said na hindi yun naman job to establish the credibility of the witnesses who gave testimonies, and then there's a job of the courts. But what if, sir, they say, the courts say, hindi credible yung witnesses, and yet tuloy na based niyo yung legislative measures on the testimonies of these witnesses that the court discredited. Where would that put us?
Well, we will cross the bridge when we get there. I do not want to preempt what the courts will say. The executive through the Department of Justice and the prosecutors would know better who among those who testified will provide a greater weight of evidence and credibility for them to secure conviction of any accused. So, kung findings po namin yun, and we are not judges, we are not all lawyers in the committee, and this is a collective decision of the committee, not just my decision. In fact, I could not even vote except to break a tie. So it is a collective decision of all members of the committee.
Sir, to follow up on Nico's question, you are going to be proposing bills out of this hearing, out of this investigation. So if you know, the policies or the laws that you propose come out of testimonies that are eventually proven to be discredited or not true, then what does that make of your proposals? Kasi diba, parang fruit of the poisonous stream him that in
doon. Not necessarily. We have our own viewpoints on what is happening to the New Bilibid prison. It is pretty clear that there is proliferation of syndicates that have converted into drug syndicates over the years. We don't need credible testimonies of inmates if that is being questioned, because in fact as a lawyer and as a criminal lawyer at that, I find their testimonies to be credible in terms of proving that there exist syndicates and or drug syndicates, and it is proliferating in the Bilibid prison. So there cannot be any other witness. Any one of you here who has not gone to the Bilibid prison would not have any personal knowledge of what is happening inside. So how can I rely on you? I would rather rely on these convicts because they are inside and they have personal knowledge of what is happening inside.
Sir, I heard from my sources that I subpoenaed at AMLC, and these are subpoenaed the suspect. Why wasn't the ALC asked to testify? And it appears that because there are many, a lot of issues that were raised concerning bank accounts. Bakit ito yung ALC? Hindi ko ninyo tinanong kung totoo ito.
Dahil alam na po namin na sasabihin nila na bawal, hindi ba? Because the law that you crafted prohibits them from divulging this information.
Yeah, but
and that is why that was the constraint of the committee, for which reason part of our legislative measure is to relax that insofar as drug personalities and inmates are concerned.
And legislative inquiries. Kasi I heard that in the Senate, tinawag ko sila eh, and they discussed lengthily what happened to the Bangladesh money laundering issue. Di ba? Why now?
Pero they did not talk about bank accounts, which are covered by bank secrecy. So, Juan at Contador na nagsabi na merong account na pinabulat-lat ng Senado na sinabi ganito yun. Wala. Okay. Unless, siyempre, whoever is the account holder will agree to open it.
Pero nga ba ang testimony ng ANLC ito? Sa AMLA? This is one of the reasons why they were able to look into the money trade. Nakuha nila, di ba? Yung mga AMLA ka...
Again, that is an executive function. AMLAC is part of executive, and I guess they can do their jobs better rather than us calling them to a committee hearing and wasting the people's time asking them without any solution.
But again,
the use of cannot AMLC, that's a fact. I'm not too sure of that.
Do we have other questions?
Okay. Nasagot na yung tanong mo kung saan kukulin yung dagdag na masakay sa mga sundalo sa
Paris. Meron ka, pamukulan.
Sa
budget.
Hindi naman siya hindi convinced. Normal na pag-iisip ka ng tao. Pinagmahan mo ng September yung EO, yung budget submit mo ng August, paano mo nasama ito? Unless si Madam Auling yung gumagawa ng proposal, yung pwede yun. Pero aside from that, I think at least they an explanation lang kung saan ang gano'n.
So okay na
kaya?
Hindi pa rin.
Hindi pa rin. Papasa na sa Wednesday. Wala, you just have to trust the system.
Whose system? Any system?
The present system.
So, if there are no other questions,
Mahirap ang tanungin si Umali dun sa committee report din, di ba?
Ano mga sa package na pinadala ng BIR? Ay, ng DOF? Ano pa ho dun yung tingin nyo na you will not accept? What provisions? Congressman Juan? Oh, okay. You will not accept or will be opposed by the members? Okay. Particularly the majority.
Siguro, alam naman na natin kung ano bringing up through your sub-media was the senior citizens discount and the exemption from the PAC and the persons with disabilities. And we didn't talk about that, but then the OF. And ang tinalo ko sa kanila ay kung pwedeng huwag na natin gawin yung privilege ng senior citizens at future families. At tulungan na lang natin na PIR na mag-hipit sa administration nito para hindi na ako so siya kasyado mo na.
I-excise tax so sa PIR?
Yes, yun ang sinabi ko, baka pwedeng pakilala natin yung more detail.
sa tingin po natin, yun kasi ang pinakamalaking item doon na they believe will generate 180 million annually. So if that's 180 million, ang revenue loss natin sa proposed nila ng personal income tax package is about 130 somewhere into that amount. So, kung mawala kasi yata ang petroleum, halos wala nang pagkutake. Pero ang sinabi naman natin, pagkaralan yung mabuti ang epekto nito sa presyo ng bilihin, sa presyo ng pagkain, sa presyo ng kuryente, sa presyo ng transport, para mapaliwanag natin sa publiko kung anong ibig sabihin ng kalokalan nila. Na 6 pesos increase in excess tax.
Parang doon sa sinasabi niya, ang non-negotiable ibig sabihin, hindi ang sinusig sector.
Well, kasi napakalit ang economic impact ng amount. 6 to 10 billion pesos annually is not going to make a dent in our revenue generation. So, mas mabuti pang pigilan na lang yung mga pag-aabuso ng privilege na yun.
Si Speaker Alvarez po, sinabi na that they will submit, sa leadership, they will submit a counter-proposal, a bill that will at least embody what they want, embody some of the finance measures. And yung sa kanya sabi, ano ba ito?
Yun nga po
yung
pinag-usapan namin last Thursday na kasama ang ating Secretary of Finance. Tulad na sinabi ko kanina, please allow us some time to firm up the details with the DOM. Kasi syempre, in motion pa lahat, fluid pa lahat ang pinag-uusapan natin. But ang main thrust nga po ng aming sinabi sa DOM is sana ma-incorporate and ma-emphasize ang importance ng efficiency in tax administration. Kaya pinagpipilitan natin sa kanila, which they welcome also, the improvement of the IT systems. Ngayong linkage ng POS system ng BAR ng mga large retailers sa BAR system. Para real-time natin mamonitor ang revenues na dapat pumunta sa gobyerno.
Sir, how long will you wait for the proposal of the or para sumagot sa inyo yung administration
well,
sa proposal?
I think naman, to be fair, they're really rushing it. In fact, they asked to, well, hindi naman si Secretary, but then one of the USECs asked to meet with me this afternoon to move a step further in our discussions.
Sir, meron namang comprehensive discussion on the economic impact of the entire proposal?
Yes, but hinihingi natin yung detailed study na gusto natin talagang hinahimayin. Yung impact on the CPI, inflation rates, impact on cost of fuel, cost of transport.
But from what you've seen, saan may pinakamalaki siyang impact?
Yung which one?
For the entire proposal. Saan yung well, pinakamabigat niyang impact sa taxpayers?
Well, like I said, ang pinakamalaking revenue source na sa kanilang package is the excise on petroleum, which they estimate at around 180 billion a year. So yun ang pinaka, kumbaga, anakip doon sa mga wawalang revenue because of the lowering of income tax.
Anyway, meron mo ba kayong mga ganito? Kasi papakutan na mga chat-chat, anong traffic change in the field. So, we have a deadline for this measure should be passed.
Well, we have a target. Ang target po natin is committee by before the end of the year.
Before the end of the year. And, where do we do?
That will depend on the plenary. It will also depend on Senate. So, hopefully, by the first of next year, up for signing na siguro. Yan ang target at least.
There's another proposal on amnesty. What's your take on this? And the amnesty will cover not only income from 2015, but also not only taxes, but also customs duties that have been unpaid or medyo nakakalusot.
Actually, hinintay natin yung proposed bill ng DOF dyan. But a few members of Congress have already filed their bills. So if I'm not mistaken, there are about two or three members who have filed bills on amnesty. And sa initial discussions with the DOF, mukhang welcome sa kanila itong amnesty. So we hope to get their version of it, and then we can consider all of them together. In fact, nag-schedule po tayo ng isang committee hearing on Wednesday, and we hope to initially discuss the subject of amnesty.
There was an amnesty in 2009 yata, parang every 9 years nagkakaroon ng amnesty. Would you see this, parang magagamitin lang ng mga delinquents yan, tax payers. Because they will be thinking that after 9 years, magkakaroon na naman tayo pagka may bago na ng Pangulo.
I really cannot speak for the people who evade taxes. But what we intend to do here is to recirculate the money that's being held outside of the tax net. So ang gusto natin bumalik yung into circulation ng capital na yan. Maybe reinvested into some businesses or to recapitalize their existing businesses. Para sa ganun, there's more investment in the country. I cannot say for sure if this is being abused by tax evaders, but siguro panahon din naman na pag-aralan o pag-usapan mo din ang pag-uha sa isang amnesty package.
Kung nalang meron ka pang-mention of that, I'm going to go to the next one. Good grades coming from the citizens right now comes with a caveat that we do it tax reform. So that yung grade mo na yun can go down if we don't do anything. Now, kailan yung point na yun na matatamaan na tayo or our penetrating or interest rate will be affected if we do not pass this tax reform? Is it next year, 2 years from now? I think that's something to communicate with members of Congress para tulungan kami. Kami tutulong kami sa'yo. We should know when the deadline should be.
Siguro ang sa credit rating agencies, sa tingin ko po, in my limited experience, syempre mas malawak ang experience ni then Secretary Ataya, no? But sa tingin ko po, bukod sa tax reform package, makikita naman nila ang financial policy ng ating administration. So nakikita nila that this administration is focused on spending and building infrastructure. And they will see that spending in infrastructure will boost economic activity. This will also contribute to trickling down the benefits to the grassroots. So, but that being aside, I think for this package to be most effective socially and economically, dapat siguro mapasa ito before the end of next year, at the latest. So, but we're hoping to do this before then, para makapag-adjust ng BAR sa administrative side. Kasi pag pinasa mo ito, magbabago ang formulas, magbabago ang administration schedule. So at least sana matapos to first half of next year.
Okay, with that, we would like to thank our Deputy Acting First Counsel, Deputy Speaker Mandaya, Chair Kua, and Chair Mandy, and his team. Thank you for raising today's press briefing.
I'm going to go to the side.
Kaya kumalap ko pa sa ito.